Let us pray. O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight this morning. Amen. The invitations have been sent, the food has been bought, the house has been cleaned, even those corners that are normally missed during weekly tidying. All is ready to welcome the guests. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. It's one thing to be in the position of welcoming others into your church, into your home, into your life. You have the power. You get to make the decisions as to whom you'll invite and when. You can control the circumstances, the setting, and the surroundings. You are able to determine when the welcoming will come to an end. It's an entirely different situation, however, when you find yourself on the other side, the one being welcomed, the one at the mercy of another, the one wondering if the welcome will ever be for you as well. Now, I was in this situation numerous times in my call and search process when looking for a new church, never knowing what would be asked or expected or how long that dreaded interview would take. Now, I say dreaded only because of the not knowing. Now, some search committees would try and woo me with a welcome basket in my hotel room, filled with local favorites and specialties, wining and dining me every single second during that visit. Others treated me as an obligation, so they could check off the female box and could honestly assure the conference that, yes, they had actually talked to a female candidate. Now, others, most, fell somewhere in between these two extremes. Awkward, exhausting, exposed, vulnerable. Those are the words that immediately popped into my head every time the possibility of another interview arose. From this brief and seemingly benign statement of Jesus, we realize a key component of the realm of God, and that is vulnerability. Brené Brown defines vulnerability as uncertainty, risk, and emotional exposure. I'd like to think that Jesus knew the true meaning of vulnerability. After all, to be human is to be vulnerable. And so therefore, we should expect vulnerability to be at the very heart of the incarnation. But vulnerability is not the same as weakness. When I look at the church today, its structures, its institution, its seminaries, its leaders, I see a church that has misconstrued vulnerability as weakness. And when an institution or a system or a leader begins to perceive its gradual loss of power, its potential demise, the last thing it wants to be is branded as weak. And churches are not immune to what the world thinks it desires and needs to maintain vigilance in making sure that the church doesn't fall under the spell of the consumer-driven ethos of our world, The church is the church when lives are changed. It is church when it inspires people to serve the common good. It is church when it helps people love themselves, love God, and love their neighbor. The church is the church when it allows its vulnerability to motivate it to speak truth to the powers that would call us weak. All too often, when vulnerability is misunderstood as weakness, the end result is foreign to Jesus and what he modeled for his followers. It becomes a self-absorbed, self-aggrandized sense of governance that does not inspire followers, but requires an allegiance through the weakness that they might exhibit. Empathy and hope are thrown out the window. As Brown continues and notes in his writing, when I look at narcissism through the weakness lens, I see the shame-based fear of being ordinary. I see the fear of never feeling extraordinary enough to be noticed, to be lovable, to belong, or to cultivate a sense of purpose. And when the church falls into this misinterpretation of vulnerability versus weakness, it sidelines the very truth that could make it strong, that God stands in solidarity with humanity. And our fundamental need for connection and belonging, intimacy and love. Vulnerability sounds like truth and feels like courage. Truth and courage aren't always comfortable, but they are never weakness. And that's what we as a church are called to. Unfortunately, in its efforts to claim relevance and not be labeled as weak, the church avoids this discomfort and has adapted itself to the world's assumptions on power. The church, for the most part, plays it safe, rather than taking risks that depend on mercy. It covers up its ideologies rather than apologize for the way in which it has been complicit in its unwelcome. Rather than model the inherent vulnerability of the incarnation, it has placed all of its proverbial eggs in the basket of the crucifixion, thereby continuing to justify suffering as a hallmark of faith, sinfulness as that which prevents celebrating our worth, and shame that stands in the way of our being loved as God loves us. Now, don't get me wrong. This is not an argument for avoiding the cross. It's an appeal. An appeal for a way to view the cross as more than securing atonement. It is a plea to imagine doing church, a way of doing discipleship that is more representative of our biblical witness of openness and extravagant welcome. Somewhere along the line, we lost our view of the fact that God becoming human in the child, the infant of Christ, was as much of a commitment to vulnerability as God's death on a cross. We have a vulnerable God. Relationships, by definition, are vulnerable. By instigating a relationship with us, God decided and determined that vulnerability is at the heart of faith. So in the face of excuses and grumblings, disbelief and disobedience, refusal and rejection, God keeps coming back, adamant that reconciliation and renewal are possible. certain of love for us, willing to be seen over and over again, even in the face of denial and betrayal. In the end, God had to trust in the welcome of the world to make a home here, to abide here, to make the realm of God be here and now. When we start to imagine what it must feel like to rely on the welcome of others, perhaps then we will have a sense of the kind of vulnerability that Jesus knew and Jesus lived. When you have to depend on another, perhaps even for a meal or a place to sleep, trust steps through that door first. When we allow ourselves to be welcomed, perhaps that's the first step to letting go of thinking we are not enough, to thinking that the church is weak, to feeling that we are less than, by remembering that we were first welcomed by God, embracing our vulnerability, we can remain and become even more welcoming of others. Amen.